Hello. Dr. Martin Luther King reminds us in his written and oratorical stylings that there comes a time when one must take a position that is neither safe nor politic nor popular, but one must do it because conscience tells us it is the right thing to do. Good day, ladies and gentlemen. Let me begin my remarks by thanking Dr. Yu-Ying Song for the nomination and invitation to address you today. Also want to extend my appreciation and thanks to Ms. Candy Wan, Bevan Johnston, as well as Chris Condean for the assistance with the logistics of preparing this presentation. Colleagues, I want to talk to you today about leading versus managing, courageous postures amid cultural legacies. In doing so, I make the following assumptions. First, that there's a difference between managing an organization and actually leading one. Second, the challenge of leading for people of color in senior executive positions represents a contrast between traditional expectations of leadership on one hand and the pull to represent the tenets of a cultural worldviews that are sometimes less supported in the roles of executive leadership. The third assumption I make recognizes that because the opportunity to highlight whatever administrative and executive skill a culturally diverse leader possesses was made possible by people who struggled, sacrificed, marched, and even died for the right to exercise one's confidence in senior administration, there's a psychic drive or instinctual urge that presents, right, each of us with an impulse to fulfill rather than betray a legacy, right? Particularly for those who are culturally conscious. The last assumption I make, I believe that the willingness to exercise one's voice, not an echo, but a voice, and assume a posture of advocacy for systemic change in organizations requires a level of risk-taking and courageous action that represents a context of a high risk, high reward for that leader. Now, with those assumptions in place, let me continue with the essence of my presentation. In my years as an administrative executive, I've learned that the difference between managing an organization and truly leading one, right? Managing is simply about having administrative control and authority to develop and execute policy. We hire and supervise personnel in various roles and steward financial resources of the institution to try to meet the goals, but we do so by virtue of our position and title. And given those titles and positions, managers are able to control and dictate the movements and activities of those that they supervise. That's managing. Leading, on the other hand, leading is less about control and more about guiding people in a way that is more intentional, to move in a particular direction and create an environment that allows people in their organization to thrive and to follow a vision of possibility that enhances the ability of those individuals to contribute to the growth, success, and even transformation of an organization. I'm reminded of this moment by Sheryl Sandberg. In her thoughts on leadership, she invites us to consider that taking initiative pays off because it's hard to visualize someone as a leader if he or she is always waiting to be told what to do. Peter Drucker, another manager and institute, on the other hand, argues that leadership is lifting a person's vision to high heights and raising a person's performance to higher standards and building a personality beyond its normal limitations. So within the context of leadership, I've also been influenced by scholars and others like Harvard's Lee Bowman and Terrence Deal, who offer four domains of leadership for consideration. These include, as I remember, structural leaders and human resource leaders and political leaders and symbolic leaders. And yet, even in their conceptual templates, along with Drucker and Sandberg, for the types of leaders, each of them fails to capture, I think, several important elements of leadership, particularly those attributes that characterize my style as a singular leader. One is a reluctant leader. Two is a culturally conscious one. You see, I come to you today with a posture as a reluctant leader, who, if truth be told, never aspired to be a university president or even a senior executive. On the contrary, I was content being a psychologist of African descent, and an African-centered one at that, whose roles as an academician, clinician, scholar, researcher, and consultant were enough for me to manage. And yet, the invitations to serve at higher levels of the organizational hierarchy that I've received in my career echo the voice of my first mentor and MZ, the great Dr. Joseph White, who you see behind me. He reminded me to consistently produce excellence and that excellence would bring opportunities. He was also clear, right, that in the context of one's trajectory toward career success, the key to mental health in the field of psychology in America was to develop a broad range of choices and options in one's endeavors. That is what I've tried to do. Now, my reluctance to serve in executive leadership, whether on university campuses or in professional organizations, like the Association of Black Psychologists, which I've been the president of, or the Association for Multicultural Counseling and Development of the American Counseling Association, was based on an acute understanding of the enormous responsibility that leadership brings. And yet, that hesitation that I experienced needed to give way to the encouragement from others who were explicit in their desire for leadership potential they saw in me, and to manage both those organizations that they were a part of and the operational dynamics that needed to be addressed. So I became a willing participant. Now, having served as a chief executive for some 3 years now as university president, and a senior executive and vice chancellor for 10 years prior to that, I can say quite confidently, my friends, that the demands of presidential leadership in an institution like the California State University, Dominguez Hills, presents several opportunities and challenges. Let me review. The opportunities center around creating an atmosphere of intellectual rigor and the free and rigorous exchange of ideas, right? Exciting student passions, engaging their intellects, challenging their biases and preconceived notions, and fostering comfort zones of self-discovery and personal mastery for our students. They also involve helping this institution crystallize its mission as we try to close the gap between what our campus aspires to be and how that vision is operationalized every day, right, in their day-to-day work. There are also opportunities to seek to embrace the surrounding community. That surrounding community includes family, residents, corporations, civic and government officials, each of whom have a stake in the access and outcome portals of any institution. Indeed, the opportunities, my friends, are abundant. That's what we as presidents do. But presidential leadership in a university environment, is also confronted with tremendous challenge in this day and time. These include community safety during COVID, shared governance, managing board of trustees, faculty unions, staff unions, state and local government entities, the recruiting of stronger, capable faculty, staff, and administration. What about faculty workloads and commensurate compensation, academic freedom, free speech, public safety personnel, and police, by the way, whose needs to protect and serve must be synthesized with the recognition that university environments are educational institutions and not penal ones. We have to manage recruitment, retention, graduation of qualified and diverse student bodies, managing protests and disruptions amid the tensions of the broader social climate, developing space and appropriate new infrastructure for academic instruction, labs, athletics, student-centered activity, university advancement. What about the development activities they engage in? Online learning, the value of a degree in the minds of the public, accreditation, issues of civility, managing diversity across the entire campus, providing support for mental health services, confronting issues of racism and racial insensitivity, as well as sexual assault and violence against women on college campuses. Without question, the management of these issues and others requires a strong and capable leader. And it requires one who understands how to embrace and operationalize the concept of a servant leader. Now, in reflecting on my journey to become a president, I'm also reminded of the great scholar W.E.B. Du Bois, who challenged us to interrogate several questions. Among those were the queries: what does integrity look like in the face of oppression? And what does truth look like in the face of deception? Now, I've come today to add another, asking what does leadership look like in the face of opportunity and challenge? So in focusing on opportunities and the influence of my African-centered cultural traditions, I've reminded myself, particularly amid the COVID crisis, budget cuts, fiscal challenges, social injustice, and the collective sometimes takes precedent over the individual. The collective should take precedence over the individual in my cultural worldview. And I've learned to lead with love and not fear. Let me say that again. I learned to lead with love, not fear. In my experience, I've learned, much like John O'Brien argues in his 2009 text on love leadership, that love works and fear fails. So consequently, in leading people I work with every day, I invite them to consider avoiding the 8 out of 10 reasons why something can't be done in lieu of the 2 out of 10 why it can. See, in this regard, I strive to focus their sights on what is possible and resist settling for what is typical. I invite them and the members of their teams to dream, for as Langston Hughes reminds us in his work, that we should hold fast to dreams, for if they die, life is just a broken winged bird that cannot fly. I invite leaders in my organization to understand that vulnerability is not weakness, but power. Vulnerability is power. For in fact, one can never truly discover how strong she or he can be until their moment of greatest vulnerability. I believe that. Now, in my time as a senior executive, in the positions that I've been blessed to inherit, they've also taught me that leadership for people of color extends beyond the opportunities to exercise authority because of one's role or position, because it often represents a confrontation with that inner self that must synthesize the challenges in the moment with the legacy of cultural traditions that stand in contrast to management norms. See, norms and expectations in this regard are the binding rules and requirements or standards of conduct that people adhere to because it's baked into the DNA of a culture of an organization. In this moment, I'm reminded again of my teacher, Dr. Joseph White, and his outline of the psychological themes that characterize the Black experience. And it was out of his articulation of these themes, particularly the realness and telling it like it is, and resilience and revitalization, along with Dr. White's understanding of the human psyche, that the notion of authenticity in my posture as a leader emerged. And so in these moments, my friends, where the need to speak intersects with a more poised and sterile institutional posture, I recognize, even as university presidents need to keep it real. We need to keep it real. And so in reality, the most profound dissonance of culturally different and conscious leader experiences is balancing out the roles and expectations of one's position as a president with the realities of the day-to-day living in America that represent a particular level of unhealthy toxicity that often assaults the intellectual, emotional, behavioral, and I would say even spiritual sensibilities of a people. Now, in essence, I'm saying that it represents the difference between what one must do on one hand and what you feel is right to do on the other. See, executive managers are expected to remain poised and objectively professional in managing university affairs in the midst of national trends, guarding, of course, against antagonizing key stakeholders who exercise oversight over our positions. They're also expected to use their voice to articulate perspectives on the challenges of higher education, staying within that lane. And yet, a culturally conscious leader, often hears the voice of the great Algerian psychiatrist, Frantz Fanon. Fanon, one of my heroes, argued that each generation out of relative obscurity must reach out and seek to fulfill its legacy or betray it. A culturally conscious leader hears Dr. White, who reminds them, right, that there comes a time, much like Dr. King said, when silence is betrayal. And in that end, Dr. King said, we will remember not the words of our enemies, but the silence of our friends. So in those moments, I feel compelled, as Cornel West reminds us, to distinguish between a voice and an echo. In doing so, I often extend my voice beyond the boundaries of a university community or the domains of higher education and use my platform to speak on issues of social justice that impact the climate we educate our students in or even treat our patients and clients in. I mean, let's take, for example, January 6, 2021, historic point in the chronicles of American democracy and the behaviors of a sitting president, and the process dynamic related to both how the event was managed or mismanaged and how insurrectionists were treated by law enforcement. It also reveals a scandalous inconsistency when compared to how demonstrators were treated, brutalized, tear gassed, and assaulted in days following the George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, and Ahmaud Arbery murders and subsequent Black Lives Matter protests and demonstrations. One can only conclude that America has a long way to go in reconciling its vicious legacy of racism and white supremacy with an aspirational self that preaches the desire to become a more perfect union. Now, in response to all of that, I issued a statement to my campus and also commentary in a Los Angeles newspaper. The challenge, of course, is that in doing so, it invites critique from those who both question why a university leader would exert such energy or express such bias in sharing my views. My views, however, didn't stop with the critique of the insurrection itself, but it also extended my analysis to the inauguration ritual many of us embrace every 4 years. You see, this January 6, 21 also took place the ceremonial certification of an election symbolizing how peaceful transition of power was supposed to take place. And I found myself as a university leader retreating back to the annals of history in search of a parallel circumstance. Where could I find it? I found myself asking the question of what does this ritual of democracy, the voting, the election, the certification process of electoral college vote really mean to me as a person of color and a male or female of African descent? Do I really have confidence, not just as an African-American psychologist, but as a citizen in our democracy, that even as I seek to engage in these civic rituals, that I will then be afforded the same rights and privileges as my white counterparts? Does my full participation in the rituals of election and inauguration frenzy insulate me as a university president or Black and brown people or Muslim brothers and sisters from the harsh realities of being in a culturally different racial or ethnic group in America? Will these election rituals erase racism and sexism, abolish discrimination, diminish anti-Semitism, stop violence against women and children, eliminate inequities in healthcare, economic opportunities or educational opportunities, address housing and food insecurity? Will they put a sizable dent in the level of poverty in this nation is experiencing? Will they reform police practices so that my Blackness is no longer a target of biased law enforcement? Will it help me obtain a more justice in the courts? Will it eliminate the redlining that increases my insurance premiums because of the neighborhood I reside in? Will it do any of that? What will democracy really do? I thought long and hard about this. And despite the status and privilege that I enjoy as a university president and distinguished psychologist with a collective sense of consciousness, I still couldn't get to yes. I mean, what do these election rituals and voting certifications really mean to me? And then there it was. The answer in our contemporary challenge for 2021 was contained in the writings of Frederick Douglass. You see, in July of 1852, some 169 years ago, Frederick Douglass delivered a famous speech on what the meaning of July 4th meant for slaves and people of African descent. And in an article I wrote for the LA newspaper, I summarized his address, where Douglass described the event as a human mockery and sacrilegious irony. In the answer to querying, asserted that for him it represented a day that reveals more than any day of the year the gross injustice and cruelty with which he's a constant victim. Your celebration is a sham, your boasted liberty and holy license, your national greatness, swelling vanity, your sounds of rejoicing are empty and heartless, your denunciation of tyrants, brass-fronted impotence, is what Frederick Douglass argued. Now, the address by Douglass was a sobering reminder about the profound sense of incongruence that has and continues to exist between what America preaches and what she practices when it comes to African Americans and other people of color. And in a contemporary context, the passions of a culturally conscious leader often instigates feelings that compel them to give voice to these issues, particularly as we teach, mentor, and advise new generations of our students on university campuses like mine. So in closing my address, my friend, I do want to highlight what a tremendous honor and privilege it is to serve in executive leadership and to lead my university. And yet, in recalling a piece of African wisdom I've stylized over time that simply says life at its best is a creative synthesis of opposites and fruitful harmony, I'm keenly aware that leading with a cultural sensibility requires more than the authority of the position and a platform to express one's views. It requires courageous spirit, undeterred by the threat of a tangible or intangible loss, and confronted by the realization that one has to truly, much like Fanon reminds us, to live out fulfilling rather than betraying the legacy we've all been blessed to inherit. With that, I'll stop and say it has been my pleasure. I thank you for listening to Midday. Take care and God bless.